The Shamoon virus that attacked Saudi Arabia's Aramco was probably the most destructive attack the business sector has seen to date.
In Saudi Arabia, during the month of Ramadan, people across the country fast, recite the Quran, and gather in mosques to celebrate one of the holiest nights of the year. It's a quiet day, but for the national oil company, Saudi Aramco, there's about to be a different kind of quiet. At 9:08 a.m., a mysterious warning is uploaded to Pastebin. It states that there is blood on the hands of the regimes of Saudi Arabia, and those regimes are funded with Aramco's oil. So for that reason, Aramco must be destroyed. With operations scheduled to begin in just 2 hours, signed by a group calling themselves the Cutting Sword of Justice. Right now, the virus, also known as Shamoon, is copying itself on every computer in Aramco's network, over 35,000 of them. Shamoon is a virtual time bomb that will detonate at a specifically programmed time and wreak havoc on Aramco, a company worth more than the likes of Amazon, Google, and Apple, a company that half the world relies on for the energy they use. And at precisely 11:08 a.m., Shamoon will... On the other side of the world, in Aramco's Houston Operations Center, an alert for unusual activity is triggered on the Saudi Aramco network. A single account has just logged in to 250 devices at the same time. The account? A domain administrator, an account that has full control over the network. Thinking that it's probably just a false positive, the head of the Operations Center decides not to open an incident to track the suspicious activity. A mistake that would soon come back to haunt Aramco, because gaining access to a domain admin account would give complete control over Aramco's network to the attackers who just got it. And with nobody tracking their movement, they would wait for the perfect opportunity to make their attack as devastating as possible. It's suspected the attackers got an initial foothold through a phishing email, where emails were sent to multiple Aramco employees with a malicious Word document attached. And when that document was opened, the macro malware inside exploits known vulnerabilities to the application used to open it. This allows a reverse terminal to be opened for the attackers, giving them access to Saudi Aramco's network. Their next step? Pivot to the domain controller, the most important server on a network. After surveilling network traffic of Aramco's internal systems, the attackers soon discovered that Aramco transmitted account credentials over HTTP, an unencrypted protocol that reveals the account's password in clear text. And shortly after that, they were able to intercept the credentials for the domain admin account. Now that they had achieved complete control over Aramco's network, they would spend the next 3 months constructing the perfect attack.
As a Saudi Aramco employee, you need to be smart. That's why you need to be this is in dealing cybersecurity.
August 15th started out as a quiet Wednesday for Saudi Arabia, and almost everyone had the day off work to celebrate the holiday, the night of power. The Saudi Aramco office was nearly empty. Just a skeleton crew of mostly foreign employees were there to keep the lights on. The attackers knew an opportunity to strike against Saudi Aramco had finally presented itself. And at exactly 9:08 a.m., the mysterious pastebin is posted by the Cutting Sword of Justice, warning of the destruction to come. And exactly 2 hours later, at 11:08, Shamoon and began by copying itself to other computers and then creating a persistent service named NTS Service, allowing the virus to remain persistent on a computer. While this is happening, Shamoon's reporter is sending information on its progress back to its operators in real time. And using commercial software called Raw Disk, Shamoon is able to get direct user access to the hard drive. It then deletes every single file on the computer it infected, and overwrites the master boot record of the computer, overwriting those erased files with corrupted data, essentially turning 35,000 of Aramco's computers into paperweights. At the same time across the Aramco network, computers displayed a video of a burning American flag. Shamoon would go on to finish the destruction of over 90% of Aramco's computers. Every saved file, every piece of software, The backup servers, nearly everything, had been deleted. The computers wouldn't even boot. They would just display the message, operating system not found. It didn't take long for Aramco to find out that something was very, very wrong. Multiple emergency meetings were held, where panicked executives would soon come to realize just how serious the hack had been. They argued back and forth over what should be done next, but ultimately turned to the CEO, Khalid Al-Faleh, to make a decision. With so much uncertainty over what had made them vulnerable to the attack, and fearing the industrial systems that controlled drilling sites would be targeted next, Khalid decided to take the company completely offline. Aramco employees across different offices frantically started unplugging all of their systems that were still functional, and before completely disconnecting themselves from the rest of the digital world, an ominous post was made to the public Saudi Aramco Facebook page that said, "We are suffering from some sort of digital or cyber attack, and we have chosen to disconnect our business operations and production from the internet." While nobody in Aramco had any idea what had actually happened at that time, it was later found by analysts that Aramco was so vulnerable to Shamoon because Aramco had focused their security on industrial systems. These remained operational, as they were isolated from the main network, but Shamoon was able to proliferate so quickly because Aramco's network was completely flat. A flat network is like a warehouse. Once you're in the warehouse, you'll have access to everything inside because there's no other walls or rooms. There's no segmentation. Once you're in, you have access to everything in the building. Secure networks are typically partitioned into different logical subnetworks. This is done to limit lateral movement and how far an attack can spread. And amongst the chaos and confusion of Shamoon taking down Saudi Aramco, Qatar's national oil company, RasGas, was also targeted in a Shamoon attack just a few days later. RasGas is responsible for about 15% of the energy produced globally. And when combined with Aramco, that's almost half of the world's energy production halted in a week's time. If the public learned of this news, it could potentially create a ripple effect across the globe, creating worldwide panic with the thought of a looming energy crisis. Aramco executives decided that figuring out the extent of Shamoon's damage and trying to recover their computers, if it was even possible, would take months. Drastic measures had to be taken immediately. Using their whole private fleet of planes, Aramco employees were flown out to Southeast Asia, where they purchased over 50,000 new hard drives right off the factory line. During this time, Aramco was also desperately trying to hire as many security consultants and vendors as they could in Saudi Arabia, but they couldn't find enough talented people they were confident could take on this kind of job. Dozens of top cybersecurity experts from all over the world were hired and flown in to analyze Shamoon, along with helping to rebuild Aramco's infrastructure in a more secure manner. And after a couple of weeks of around-the-clock work spent securing the network, Aramco released a public statement, admitting to the hack, but claiming that business had returned back to normal. It wouldn't take long before the statement would be exposed as a lie. Even though the industrial systems hadn't been hit by Shamoon, operations there were still massively affected. They could still get the oil out of the ground, but there were no computers to tell them where oil should be shipped, how much, and to who. Oil trucks began getting backed up for miles in the chaos of it all, as Aramco had not communicated to customers all of the details of the attack, and they were still trying to make deliveries. This long line of trucks was seen and photographed by a journalist, and soon after, news spread rapidly that Aramco had lied, and that the hack was a lot more serious than they had let on. As more details made their way into the public eye, Mansour Al-Turki of the Saudi Interior Ministry stated that the attack had come from an organized group on four continents. The cutting sword of justice, expecting that they would be acknowledged for their attack. The group followed up with another statement on Pastebin, this time containing a warning that they weren't done with Aramco yet. And below that message, they published internal information of Aramco's systems and the accounts that were utilized to carry out their original attack, leaving no doubt that the cutting sword of justice was in fact responsible for the attack. The attacks on Aramco continued, this time in the form of multiple denial of service attacks, where the attackers flooded the bandwidth and resources of Aramco's online services, taking them offline again, another three separate times, while they were still in the process of rebuilding everything. These attacks weren't as serious as the first, but they still slowed Aramco's recovery. It would take a full 3.5 months from the first attack before operations truly returned back to normal. As things started to settle down, Aramco discovered the newest paste bin, along with the older ones posted by the Cutting Sword of Justice. On the surface, they appeared to be an activist group, but some of the writing in the paste bins made that title questionable to Aramco and the Saudi Arabian government. They tried to establish motives, and theorized that it had to have been Iran that was responsible, acting in retaliation over Saudi Arabia's ties to the US, and maybe because of the devastating Stuxnet attack that had previously hit their nuclear facilities. However, Iran denied that they had been responsible for Shamoon. But another theory emerged as forensic experts continued to analyze how Shamoon had entered Aramco's network and propagated. They found that only a person with higher administrative privileges in Aramco's network could have spread Shamoon, and that the first infected computer had received it locally using a USB. If this is true, this would mean that an Aramco employee would have had to been the person to infect the first computer. Even if it's never learned who is responsible, a lesson was learned on how important cybersecurity is for organizations and just how closely it's tied to our critical infrastructure.